Hello guys, my name is Daniele Angelozzi, also known as Danko, and I've been using ZBrush for 14 years, and well, for me it really was a game changer for my creativity and profession. Today I would like to show you a nice technique that I use often in my workflow that takes advantage of the way that the layer brushes interact with the morph target feature. I use this approach anytime I have to create stuff like scales or airs, spikes, all the details in which I don't want to have the effect of the alphas stamped one close to the other to create the sense of overlaps. Because you know, one of the most common techniques to create details is just take brush, associate to it one alpha that you can have created or purchased, select the right type of stroke and the right intensity, and start creating stamps of these alphas. So let me raise up the intensity, okay, like this. And there is a problem, no matter how hard you try with setting maybe a radial fade to make the borders being more blurred and with the focus shift, you will always end up with some artifact. You will always have this sort of patched look in which you can really spot even from the far that there are zones in which the intensity is higher and the intensity is lower, because this corresponds to the center of the brush and this is the outer part. And the other thing is that no matter how hard you place, you play with the placement and again the focus shift and the radial fade, whenever you have alphas that come one on top of the other here, you will always have the sense of overlapping taking place, so detail on top of another detail, so the scale here is not so clean. So there is a nice workaround that even though will always require you to put a minimum of effort to create nice detailing and to create some cleanup, because we always want to put some sort of creative thinking in our detailing, will make the need of this cleanup stage less extreme. And I came out with this idea once that to create details for a reptile skin. So let's start with some quick theory just to understand the logic of this technique. In order to do this, I want to start with a simple plane and make this a polymesh, because sometimes thinking in terms of flat surfaces helps getting the logic better. So I will subdivide, let's say, to 1 million polygon. So every type of brush in ZBrush has this logic. So I will raise for a second up the intensity and lower down the focus shift on my standard brush just to have a stronger stroke. Whenever I'm going, well, maybe this is way too low as focus shift, so let's make this less extreme. Whenever I'm going on top of a surface in ZBrush, basically I'm using a particular algorithm that is the brush type, base type, to deform the surface. So I'm pushing the points inside or outside based on the Z-add or Z-sub and the particular algorithm. The logic is that whenever I go on top of something that has already details, in which the surface is modified, it will keep adding detail on top of the details. The addition will be based on what lies underneath. And this is the logic behind the fact that if I have some alpha of a scale and I have another scale, those two scales will somewhat overlap together. There is a particular brush inside of ZBrush, or a base type, brush type, that is the single layer. I will select this layer brush. That works in kind of slightly different way. So I will make a high intensity and again put a low focus shift to have a super crisp detail. By default, this layer brush will act as any other type of brush. So let's say that the plane is depth value of zero. So whenever I go with this brush, let's say that I'm adding something, and let's assume that this is one. If I put another one, another stamp that will add one, whenever I go on top of zero, it will become one. But if I go on top of something that has already one, this part will become two, because you can see that it's kind of double the detail. And so if I keep adding, here I will have two, and here I will have three, and on and on and on. But I can, with this brush, store a morph target. Basically, storing a morph target will store the actual version of the tool and keep it in memory. And when I have a morph target stored, the amazing fact and the cool fact of the single layer brush type is that it will not add to the surface based on the actual actual tool, but it will always look at the morph target version to keep adding detail. What I mean is that now I have saved the stamp of my plane here just to for you to remember that this is the morph target. So if now I add one and I will create another one, whenever I go here, it will not keep into account, take into account that here there is one, but we'll see that in the morph target it is zero. The consequence is that if I go over on this, it will not add. So one, one, and in the joining part will be one. There is a cool consequence of this. There are a lot of cool consequences, but the main one is that if I have something that adds less than one, it will look like it's going underneath, but just because here the detail is higher, so it will not keep adding. And here is higher, so it will add, but not carry with it the detail of the scale. Another cool consequence, because if you start to connect the point, is that if I have an alpha that kind of creates some sort of gradient, so let me get rid of the radial fade value. Okay, you can see that in the parts in which the detail is higher, they will go higher, so let me... Okay, in which the detail becomes lower, it will become lower. So with this I can really create scales that are not overlapping, because now I can go and select this nice chameleon. Let's be sure that I have a layer selected. Okay, and I will find, okay, this is a scale alpha that I've created by myself. So basically, if I have a morph target stored, I can, okay, let's store a morph target. I can use this to create scales that don't overlap. Nowadays, whenever I have to create this sort of reptile skins, I use this approach. I first of all lay down a repeated pattern as surface noise. So basically, this tool has UVs, and I take advantage of the UV to go under the noise and associate the dialable alpha that will be driven by the UVs. So with this I can say okay, and now instead of applying the noise, I really don't want to apply the noise, because by applying the noise I will have some parts of the mesh being pulled inside and some pushed outside. For this particular technique I always want my detail to go kind of for the most part outside. So instead of applying, I will just mask by noise, invert the mask, and inflate on a positive value those scales. Okay, like this. Not too much, because I really want to create any sort of a realistic detail. Now, if I select any type of layer brush, and this is of course a single layer brush, I can create scales, and the logic is that if the intensity of the scale is higher, it will pop out from this sort of layer. Otherwise, if it's less, it will go under. I can really use any type of single layer brush, and if I expand my brush menu I can see that I have those three, Kiesel, Kiesel 3D and Kiesel Creature, that in theory are single layer brushes. So I can take these and I can also create spikes, and those spikes you can see that will come out here. They clean up also the scales, because there are parts that go inside in this brush, but you can see that I can really create those details without having this sense of overlap. There is a small issue, and I want to mention, because in the beginning it drove me kind of mad. There is this Kiesel 3D that, even if in theory is a single layer type, will have some issues, because even if there is a morph target, you can see that the details will add on top of the other. So this is important to know, even if you want to create your own VDM, because if you start from this, you will carry with you this issue. So always start the creation of your VDM with the Kiesel or the Kiesel creature, not this Kiesel 3D. How to create a 1-1 alpha? Real quick, I will now select a plane, okay, make a poly mesh, and again I will subdivide, let's say, up to 200,000 polygons. And in order to create our VDM, the logic is that we want to have a perfect square plane. So when I subdivided, the border was smoothed, but in order to fix this, I can go here under deformation and perform a morph to grid up to 100. So with this set, I will activate the symmetry, and real quick, I will start to sculpt some scale detail. It will not look so amazing because we are short of time, so I will just blur a bit. I have a shortcut associated with the blur mask, and I will mask in some shapes for this scale, okay, like so. So let's move. I can also play with the lower subdivision like this, and I will deactivate the perspective. And I want to be sure with the move infinite depth that I have some sort of tapering, because remember that I want the scale from the root to the tip to kinda become higher, so it will allow me to create this sense of overlaps. I could also play with some sort of slight undercut. Just watch out that if you have extreme undercuts, sometimes you will want to activate the back face mask or the depth mask, because even if with the morph target it could create other type of artifacts. I'm not going really into this topic for this video, but just for you to know. Let's say that we want to create this sort of snake or dragon scale type with those ridges on the border. Real kick. Once I've done this, if I want to be sure that this is still a perfect square, if I fear that I have touched the borders, I can mask by feature, invert the mask. It will mask only the outer borders, because I don't have polygroups or whatsoever. And only on this unmasked part, I can reperform a morph by grid. Now I can take my Kiesel creature, and I have two options. I can go here under the brush and create a multi-alpha brush. It will totally replace this collection and take every subtool of this tool to create one element of the collection. Or if I want to add this to the pre-existing collection, I can click this from mesh. Now I can go back here on my chameleon, and you can see that with this scale I can really perform this sort of black magic. And you can see that whenever with the drag rectangle I'm creating bigger scales, so whenever the scale is lower it will be down on the pattern, so below the pattern, but when it becomes bigger it will start to show out. And I have created this with this sort of from the tip to the root being always lower, because in this way I can make this part look like it's really coming out. I really can use any type of alpha like this, and I can use this technique for every type of stuff. Just to mention real quick, also for air it can be useful, because I can create let's say the basic shape for the air, and then with just a layer brush set with, let's say, kind of smooth alpha like this dots, I will lower down the lazy step just to be sure that it makes a nice continuous stroke like this. Now maybe I want something that is smoother. Usually I will create my alpha set as I want, and for this I always like to use the layer, not the Kiesel, because the Kiesel is kind of too strong. But let's pretend that this is the right one. I can store a morph target, and I can start to create air. And when I, with this air, you can see that when I go over on another air, it will not create the sense of this sort of step. And this is cool, because I can also play with different intensity to create different layers of air. And also remember that, let's say that we want to add another layer of air on top, so I could also lower down for a second the total intensity by performing a slight morph. So you can see I'm pushing the detail towards the original morph target, and then Now I can still add other fibers that I know that will go over on the pre-existing ones. So I hope you enjoyed the video and this technique. Happy ZBrushing to everyone. Stay safe and ciao.